Very good morning to one and all present over here. I am Nikita Moghe, and the project that we've done in our summer school is titled HollyChat, Domain-Specific Conversational Agents. The moment I throw in the word chatbots, you must be probably thinking about Cortana, Allo, Siri, and you will be like, this is a solved problem. What's so fun in it? Turns out it isn't. We all know they suffer from a lot of problems, such as they are incoherent. Some of them suffer from poor NLG. It is difficult to maintain context. And there are a lot of problems which I don't want to go into details right now. If we observe clearly, these chatbots lack from one specific problem. It's that they are one thing which talks about everything. It will be history, it will be math, it will be science, and that's why they have this failure. So what we are trying to do is we are trying to build domain-specific conversational systems. When we had proposed our problem, we said that we would work on the domain of movies and products and build something which is expert in it. During the course of workshop, we focused largely on the movie domain, but our goal is to build something which is domain agnostic. Now, what do I mean by building domain agnostic bots is that we will be looking into procedures and resources that can be a plug and play. So, we prioritized on problems which were common to both movie and product domain. One interesting question to all of you. So what do people do when they talk about movies? Even we scratched our heads for a lot of time. We came up with a very simple solution. We just went and asked them. That is, we started with something known as our in-house data collection drive. We had this thing set up in IIT Madras before coming to the workshop, where we asked our students to pick a movie and chat about that movie for 15 utterances. That movie has to be from the IMDb 250 or any popular list which is floating on the internet, and ensure that you have actually watched the movie, because we did not want their opinion to be biased by the internet. We got a good genres of data. So what did we actually learn from this data? We learned that conversations are nothing but a game of chess. It has a set of opening moves where you decide which movie do you want to talk about. Then it has a mid-game where you actually talk about the movie, some intricate details, some plot-based questions, and an end-game where you typically have a trivia or a recommendation game coming into the picture. We have more algorithmic details in coming over in few slides. Then we label this data, and we have some specific labels that I need to talk to you about. One is a question. What is your opinion about the movie 12 Angry Men? This is that we had asked them to chat for about 15 turns. So we found that 2.37 utterances were questions. Topic switch is when you start with one movie and then you go on another movie. Say I talk about The Dark Knight, but then I want to talk about Tim Burton's Batman as well. Return to topic is when I started talking about Dark Knight, then I spoke about Tim Burton's Batman, but then I realized no, Dark Knight was better. Comparison. Yes, we all like to compare different actors, and I don't think I need to explain more in detail. We have not analyzed every utterance in the chat. We focused on things which were required to build a minimalistic strategy that can you keep the user engaged. We'll have more details on it later. So yeah, it seems cool. We collected data, we'll just scale it up, we'll throw machine learning, and the bot is up. But that's not how it sounds. We face certain difficulties. First thing is speed. We had asked them to chat just for 15 statements. We said them it will not take you more than 7 minutes, but then the average time taken was 28 minutes. Another thing, when we said, oh, we'll pay you, you just have to chat about movies, we had a good enthu, but then eventually people who participated were 78. Cost, this was a major factor. When we told them that we'll pay you 10 rupees per person per chat, they did not agree. They said that no, we want 20 rupees per person per chat, and if my math is right, this is the amount that we need to collect for 25k, which is typically not what you want to spend for data collection. So do we all lose hopes? No, we have a silver lining. We came with something called as an incremental chat collection. So I think if you are working in crowdsourcing, you know how IMT works. So for those who haven't used it, Amazon Mechanical Turk requires you to put in a statement and whatever the task may be. But then the catch here is that you have atomic tasks. you need two people to do a dialogue. So how would we go about it? What we did is that we classified one utterance as one atomic task. We had this set of premise set up where we had given them a context where we had told them that this is an imaginary scenario and imagine that you are the you in this and chat about it. For example, we had given them a premise, let's talk about Titanic. We gave them three options that probably the user could say, what is your favorite scene in the movie? What is your opinion? Do you like Kate Winslet? Now imagine that you are the person who is supposed to talk next. To do this, we had five popular movies from each six genres. Then the branching factor, as in what is your favorite scene in the movie was thrown to three different talkers. We collected their responses. Now these each individual response was then again showed to three people. So we tapered till one because we had our time constraints and we wanted our good set of data. Yeah, when we compare it to our in-house collection drive, it is way, way cheaper. It's fast. We collected 2160, that is the final batch of data in 12 hours. So definitely it's scalable. 12 hours you get 2160 utterances. Imagine if you do it just for a week, you'll have really good data to work on. One really important aspect which came out of this was multiple references for each utterance. When you work in dialog systems, you know evaluation for dialog systems is a very hard problem. There is no single answer. So at least which the current data sets show that there is only one response, using this, we have three responses for every utterance, which is still a decent number to work on. Yeah. Then we all have our doubts. Okay, it's crowdsourcing. Do the people really follow the instructions? So we defined two metrics where we labeled all the chats that were collected on intelligibility and coherence. And the scale was 1 to 3. I'll just give you a moment to look through the chat. So if you observe that the first four utterances were given by us, the you friend are six different people. And it turns out that 90% of the chat scored 3 on both the metrics, which means that yes, it's a win-win situation for us. So to give you a comparison of what the data distribution is between our in-house data and the AMT data, this is something. So one thing I would like to make you note of here is that the in-house data, what we had worked on was 15 utterances. Here it was 6 utterances. So the numbers add up. Another aspect is that the average number of utterances here was 17.2 as compared to 10. This is because this was posted on AMT and then the users are in a very hurry to go about it, where here this was a very relaxed environment. One more thing is that the switches came in late in the in-house data because the movie was pre-decided, so they discussed a lot on the movie and then moved to another movie. Whereas in AMT, you were not sure whether you wanted to continue talking about that movie. So with a brief introduction about the problem and data collection, I'd ask Mitesh sir to take over from here.
Thanks, Nikita. So far the point is that eventually we are interested in data-driven models for conversation systems. And where is the data? So that is the part about where is the data. We have come up with an idea which allows it to quickly collect a lot of data from crowdsourced workers. And we have also done some feasibility checks showing that the data collected from the crowd is usable, it's intelligible, it's coherent, and it also has very similar characteristics to what you would collect from in-house users. Right? So this is a scalable way of collecting large-scale data, which can then be fed to a lot of machine learning algorithms to do data-driven conversational agents.
Switch and return to topic.
Yes. So why topic switch and return to topic, right? So we are also, the reason we were analyzing this data is to understand what is a conversation strategy that two humans use when they're talking about the movie. And the eventual goal is that our bot should be made aware of such conversational strategies. The eventual goal was that we should learn from these conversational strategies and feed it to the bot. So one thing that we wanted to know is, how quickly do users start switching from one topic to another? And that's very important for the bot, because the bot would have certain knowledge base from which it's very easy for it to say a few sentences about the movie. But once you start into a deeper conversation, the bot might not have enough data to do that. But if you learn from the data that users do switch a lot of topics, then the bot could also employ the strategy that once its data has been exhausted, it could start looking at a new entity. That means I started about the movie Titanic, which has the lead actor as Leonardo DiCaprio. So I would say a few things about Titanic. But the moment my data gets exhausted, I'll immediately switch to Leonardo DiCaprio and start saying some things about him. And that allows me to engage the user for more turns. So that's why we are interested in knowing whether users actually switch when they talk about movies. If users don't do it, then it's very unnatural if the bot does. So the good thing here was that the users actually do it. So we could later on feed this to our conversation strategy, which we'll talk about later.
I have another question. Is there any cultural differences between the in-house data that you see maybe in the university here versus globally how people talk about movies?
Not really, actually. Frankly, there's hardly anything which was strikingly visible there. Apart from this difference, which we know why it is, because on the crowdsource platform, since the two users initially did not agree on a movie, it's quite likely that the new user wants to switch on that. Whereas in the in-house setup, since they agreed that we'll talk about Titanic, they are ready to talk about it for longer before switching to something else. Apart from that, in the way this conversation goes, or the vocabulary, or the style of talking, there was hardly any difference between the two.
I just want to know, this number 0.05 looks to be very, very small. Right?
Yes, yes.
So what does it exactly signify here?
Yeah, what it signifies, right? So what happens is that we start talking about a movie, then I make a context switch. Oh, I liked that romantic movie better than this. And we start talking about that movie. And then we return back to the original movie that we had started. Oh, anyways, coming back to this movie, there was this another interesting aspect of that. So that's what we call return to the original context. Now, since in the crowdsource setup, we have collected only 6 utterances. That means only 6 utterances, that means only 3 turns per user. So there's no chance for them to come back, right? Because they have just made the context switch and they have not been able to return back. So if we continue this for a few more turns, we'll start seeing people returning to the original movie, right? That's what it indicates. And that's again important for the bot to know that once I have made a switch, so a good strategy would be that for a given movie, if I have 3-4 sentences which I can say, maybe say 2 of them right now, switch to a new topic, come back to the movie, and then say the remaining 2. That looks more natural because that's what users typically do, right? So that's the whole context of analyzing this data. Okay, and the eventual goal is, of course, eventually not in the workshop, but move towards data-driven bots, which will require a large-scale data collection, and hence the idea of incremental crowdsourcing, okay?
Or did you use any other data sources?
So our
bot
currently
training?
Is not data driven because we don't have, to have a data driven bot, we'll need at least 25K to 100K chats in that domain. And that would take a longer time to collect. So right now we have something different, which I'll come towards the end, right? So, okay. Now, so far we have some way of visible way of collecting chats, and where do we go from here, right? So of course we all are interested in finding the ML and NLP problems that can be extracted from this data and solved. And the second is to learn a minimalistic conversation strategy from this data so that we could keep the users engaged for a few turns, right? So how do you evaluate the success for a bot? Is how long can you engage the user, right? If the user just types a few sentences and say, okay, I'm bored by, that means there's something wrong with your conversation strategy, right? So these are the two things that we want to talk about next. So first, coming at identifying the ML NLP problems in this whole setup, and there are tons of them. So as I said, the chat that users do are clearly divided into three parts: the opening game, the mid game, where all the major tussle happens, and then the end game, which typically ends with recommendations or trivia and so on. Right. So let's look at the opening game. Starting right from the first sentence, you need a named entity recognition, because I need to know that 12 Angry Men is actually a movie and it's not just a collection of words, 12 Angry Men. Right? So I need a good named entity recognizer. Then in the end game, you end with, you must watch To Kill a Mockingbird. Right? And you could, people who have watched these movies know that they are related, both are courtroom drama movies. So you need a recommendation engine. But why did the friend suggest this movie? Because somewhere along the lines, the user said that I love courtroom dramas. So you need an opinion classifier which can detect what the user loves and what the user hates. So don't suggest movies with the users hate and suggest which they like. Then another interesting thing which happens is people tend to ask a lot of factual questions. Who was the lead actor in the movie? So it's Henry Fonda. Okay, and this can be answered from knowledge graphs, which I've written as KG. Then what people also do is they ask these plot-based questions. Why does juror 8 hate the accused so much? And this is something which can be answered only by someone who has actually watched the movie or read the plot in great detail. So this is what we know call as ask, generate plot-based questions, right? And this is a two-way game, right? Two-street game, in the sense that It's not that the user can only ask questions. Even the bot has the right to ask questions. So now if we could have a strategy that we ask, somehow are able to ask the user questions based on the plot, then there is again an engagement strategy there, right? We could keep the user engaged because then he could answer the questions. And also this allows us to do data collection in the long run. So now later on, if someone asks us a similar question, we know the answer to that question because we have collected it from some other user, right? So generate plot-based questions. Then we have answer plot-based questions. And this is a really hard problem, right? Because imagine how you do it. The user has asked you a question. All you have is the Wikipedia plot summary of the movie or the IMDb plot summary of the movie. You have to do natural language understanding, extract information from that document, and then do natural language generation. Right? So this requires all of this to be done, which is extremely hard. Okay? And the other thing which people do is, once in the end game, so I've recommended a movie or I've recommended an actor, so I say that you should go and watch Christopher Nolan movies, and the person may not know who is Christopher Nolan. So there is always this describe. Can you tell me who is, or can you tell me what it is about? So this involves generation of descriptions from structured data. Right? And we'll come to that, what exactly is the academic problem there. And this is more relevant in the product domain. Right? So we always ask, that, okay, iPhone 6s has been released. Can you tell me something about it? So I would say it's a lightweight phone with a certain amount of RAM and a certain megapixel of camera and a certain storage and so on. And if you see, everything that I've said is actually coming from a structured knowledge base about the iPhone. So if you go to the Amazon page description of iPhone, it would say RAM so much, megapixels so much, camera so much, front yes, back no, and so on. Right? So all that which is there in the structured data has to be output as a natural language sentence to the user so that it's more accessible to the user. Right? So now why this, and of course there are many, many, many more problems which we are ignoring. Right? So you need even simple things like yes, no detection. Right? So if you say that, let's talk about Titanic, the user could say, why not? Now, why not actually means yes, but it does not have any words which are associated with yes, right? It actually has no over there. So you need, even this simple problem needs attention, right? Seemingly simple problem. And then there are things like coreference resolution. So example, you started talking about Titanic, and then the user says, who was the lead actor in it? So you should know that this it is now relevant to the Titanic. So there are tons of other problems here. But the ones which I have highlighted are these color-coded ones. So the red ones are the ones which we believe are reasonably solved in various contexts, and we could afford to use some off-the-shelf tools for these problems by minimum tweaking. So not really solving deep academic problems there, but a few engineering problems. The green ones are the ones we want to tackle as academic research problems and feed them back to the bot. And the blue one is which we think is really hard to tackle right now, so we'd like to look at it after the workshop. Right? And so now what we'll do is we'll go into these three statements, and now I'll convert them from the bot setup and abstract them out to academic problems. So the first one is answering factual questions from a knowledge graph. And this could be any knowledge graph. This could be the knowledge graph for a movie domain, for a product domain, healthcare domain, anything. Right? So the problem that you're trying to solve is answer questions from a knowledge graph. The second is natural language generation from knowledge graphs. So this is the problem of describe Leonardo DiCaprio, or tell me about Christopher Nolan, or tell me about To Kill a Mockingbird. Right? So you need to have some structured data, and you need to generate a description. And the third problem, which we took up as a stretch goal, and we are happy that we were able to make at least some progress in that, is generate natural language questions from documents. And here again, the motivation is that as a chat strategy, I could ask the user questions about a particular plot. I don't know the answer, but that doesn't stop me from asking the answer question. Because then the user would answer the question, and that I can store as my data collection. And the next time someone asks that question, I could lift it from there. Right? So that's the third thing that we want to introduce in the bot. Okay. So now coming to the first problem, which is answering factual questions from a knowledge graph. Okay. So here we would like to revisit this problem. Why I say revisit is because this was actually introduced, and there was a lot of propaganda around it in the last 2 years, around 2014, when the group from Facebook started working on it. They released some data sets. And within 1 year, people started claiming, oh, this is a solved problem. We have 93% accuracy. No need to work on this. So the points which I'm going to highlight is, no, this is not a solved problem. The current data sets have certain problems. Why the current solutions are not useful? So I'll go over these three questions. Are current data sets sufficient? Is it really a solved problem? And are the current solutions, which is something known as memory networks, which is a deep neural network architecture, is it really the right way to go forward? Okay. So let's start with the first question. Are the current data sets sufficient? So what do the current datasets offer? And just like switching context, right? So now from the overall bot perspective, we have jumped deep diving into three research problems that we are trying to tackle, and this is the first one. So what do current popular datasets offer? One is the answer, what we call as single hop questions. So who acted in Titanic? This can be answered from the knowledge graph, which has a tuple called actor, Titanic, Leonardo DiCaprio. So this is a single tuple that you need to answer this query. So knowledge graph tuples are typically these triplets where you have the predicate, which is actor or acted in. You have the subject, which is the movie, and the object, which is Leonardo DiCaprio. So from a single tuple, you could answer this question. This requires you to do just that. Further, the current datasets have very few templates. That means they correspond to very few relations in the knowledge graph, things like actor, director, producer, and so on. But when we started analyzing data and we started collecting data, we realized that people actually ask many more questions. So we want to go much beyond these 13 templates. We want to ask questions like, what's the nationality of this actor? What was his debut movie? When was he born? Who is his spouse, the last spouse, and so on. And lots of other relations which are also important in the movie domain. The second is we want to address multi-hop questions. So who is the wife of the director of Titanic, right? So here now you need to answer two questions. First, you need to say, who is the director of Titanic? So that could be answered from the tuple director, movie, James Cameron. And then you need to go to the tuple spouse, James Cameron. I don't remember her name. So that's the second tuple from which you need to answer that question, right? So this is no longer a single tuple query, this is a multi-tuple query, right? And then we have these inference style questions, which was the first movie directed by Nolan. So now you need to fetch all the tuples directed by Nolan. You need to first understand this is a direction question, fetch all the direction movies by Nolan, and then sort them and retrieve the first one, right? So this is more inference. So these are the two new question types that we're introducing. But now where do we get the data to model this, these type of questions? The solution is we create our own large-scale factual question answers data for the movie domain, right? And we'll give you more details about this data. Now coming to what are the new types of questions that we have created. So we have questions on birth date, cinematographer, debut movie, spouse, character, and so on. Lots of such questions, which are new single-op questions that we have added on top of the existing 13 types of questions which were handled. Then we have 100 new inference type style questions like last movie directed by X, which is the most popular movie starring John, and so on, right? Which all require multiple tuples to be answered. And then again, multi-hop questions like name a movie in which Quentin Tarantino is the actor as well as the director. So now you need the tuple actor as well as the tuple director to answer these questions, right? So these are all new complex types of queries that we have introduced, which are not handled in the current factual question answer literature, which people claim to be is a solved problem, right? And we collected 10 paraphrases of each of such questions. So we ended up with a movie questions paraphrase data consisting of 13K paraphrases. And this is really a huge, vastly useful data because it has a lot of paraphrases. So you could train a paraphrase detection engine on that. And instantiated each tuple with different named entities to construct a large question answering data set. What I mean by that is, now what is the birth date of John? You could replace John by Leonardo DiCaprio, Christopher Nolan, Christian Bale, Annie Hathaway, anything, right? And you could have a lot of such questions and the corresponding answers. And you have a large amount of data which can then be fed to these data-hungry deep neural models, right? So that's what we have created. Okay, so I hope I have convinced you that the first two questions, the answer is no. Current data sets are not sufficient and it is not really a solved problem. Now the third question is, are memory networks, which is the current state of the art till late 2016, are they the right solution? So I'm not going to go about the details of what a memory network is. It suffices to say that it's a deep neural network based solution for question answering. And the diagram should be enough to convince you that it's an extremely bulky solution, which is an overkill for the problem that we are trying to solve. No NLP researcher would approach the problem the way these guys have approached it. And it has a large appetite for data, right? You really need to feed in a lot of data to train it, and which is very hard to construct in every domain that you go on. And it does not scale to large KBs because they use a set of hacky heuristics, which again, I don't want to go into, which kind of makes sure that it works with only a subset of the knowledge graph which has the answer instead of working with the entire knowledge graph. So that they use certain hacky heuristics for that. So that these are the problems with this. And we take a very different approach to this problem. And we first explain what the problem is, right? So the problem is during training, You are given these set of questions, who acted in X, which could have an associate query like select from movies where name is equal to movie. And at test time, you are given a different question, which is perhaps a paraphrasing of this question, and even the movie is different, right? So at training time, your movie could have been Titanic. At test time, it could have been Interstellar, right? All you need to do is map this test question, this test question to the correct training question. That's all you need to do. So that's how we approach this problem. We propose a paraphrase detection model, which we train on the paraphrase pairs that we had collected. And we use a Siamese network with so we basically treat this as a metric learning problem using deep neural networks. And we train this using a publicly available paraphrase data. So we did not have to invest in new data, and this scales to multiple domains. And we just had to fine tune it over the paraphrase data, 13K pairs that we collected in-house, right? So that's the solution that we have. Now, how does this compare to the existing solutions? So we experimented with two data sets. One is a standard Wikimovies data set, which I introduced earlier, which had these 13 templates. And then our large scale data set, which contains more templates, multi-hop, inference constraints, and so on. And then we use the standard train, test, valid procedures. I won't give the details of the splits and all. We just did the standard procedure. So first off, on the Wikimovies data, we get much better than what the memory networks get. Then the next question was that, does the memory network scale to the size of KB that we have? And we could not even make it work, actually. It just goes out of memory, ironically. And then our model can still work. Then we had this question that, what about unseen relations, right? So what if the query question was never seen during training time? And this is, again, common in products. So for example, now some of the phones have this iris scanner, which was not there in the existing phones earlier. So this is a new relation which has been added to your knowledge graph, which says that phone X has an iris scanner. So now if I start asking questions about iris scanner, can the model generalize? So it does. There's a clear drop in accuracy. And we did a lot of cheating in favor of memory networks, not in favor of our model, to make it really work on this data. And somehow made it work, but we could not get good results with that, and slightly better with ours. So there is still a lot of work which needs to be done in the generalization aspect. So this, again, making a case that this is not a solved problem. And what is the performance of the single hop model on multi-hop queries, right? So now you have these newer queries, inference style, multi-hop, and you have a model which was trained to do single hop queries. Again, the memory networks does not even work. We get a low accuracy. And now the next thing that we are trying to do, and which is still running, is now we could fine tune this with the multi-hop questions that we have collected. And that should probably boost that, probably double that based on our past experience, right? But we don't have the numbers yet. So here the case that I'm trying to make is that we have created a larger data set, introduced new complexities to the problem, proposed a different scalable solution than the current state of the art, and which does at par or even better than the current state of the art, and introduced a few new problems which need to be solved further, right? So that's the contribution of this work. Now I'll hand over to Preksha to talk about natural language generation from knowledge graphs, which is the problem of identifying who is Matt Damon or giving a description for Matt Damon.
Okay. So the problem here is that we have been given a structured information about some entity, and we have to generate a short summary of this entity. So how this is different from a normal sequence to sequence problem? So first thing you can see here, the input is in a structured format where the input can be divided into a set of fields. The fields are born, occupation, spouse, and each field is associated with some tokens. So the field occupation is associated with actor, filmmaker, screenwriter. So clearly there is a hierarchy in the input. The next thing is, then while generating the summary, when you are generating the summary on the part occupation, so you will tend to stay on the field occupation or tend to talk about it for a while. So you will stay on that field, and then you will make a jump in the summary to some other field. So basically, as you can see in the summary, while generating is an American actor, film producer, and screenwriter, you are always on the field occupation. Now once that is done, you will not come back to the field occupation while generating the summary. So that should be also captured in our model. That is, once a field has been already captured in the description, you should not again generate those words in the summary again. So This can also be extended to the product domain, as sir already suggested, that given a description, a technical detailed description about a product, you should generate a human readable format summary for that product. So how we are tackling this problem is by using the famous recurrent neural network architectures. So first basic model is that you don't take the hierarchy into account. You just pass the tokens as a sequential sentence where the first John Doe is the name, birth date, then the occupation. So here, while generating each word of the summary, say the first word John, you'll attend to the tokens which are needed at that time. So while generating the word John Doe, you'll probably pay attention to the first two tokens in the input. So that is the basic sequence to sequence model. Now to account for the history in this model, we have a field level RNN where you first process the token level information and then pass it to the field level information. Say John Doe information will then be passed to name, and then while generating the summary, you pay attention to the fields. So while generating John Doe, you'll pay attention to the name and based on which a particular word John will be picked up. So this is how we captured the hierarchy in the structured data. The next thing is to capture the stay on or never look back property. That is, once you are on occupation field, you should stay on that field for a while actor, filmmaker and director is being generated. Is we have to account for the history of this fields that have been attended to. So here we again have a recurrent neural network which will capture the history of the fields that have been attended to on top of the field attention. So this way we model the stay on and never look back property in the structured data. So here are we used blue metric for evaluation. What is blue metric is, it gives a roughly an idea of how much words in the generated field, in the generated summary, overlaps with the gold summaries that we have. So this work was previously done in EMNLP. So the baseline used a normal feed forward neural network architecture, and they had they were able to achieve a blue score of 34.7. But incrementally, appending the hierarchy, stay on and never look back in our models, we could reach to a blue score of 42, which is way better than the baseline. So the next question we tried to handle is, does this model generalize well? So why do we need this? Is as sir suggested, that when new products come, new relations or new fields will come in their description, like is iris scanner present? No, yes or no. So if such entities or such technical descriptions we don't have, does the model generalize well? So for that, we did these experiments. So the model was trained on a biography data set, which was the wiki info boxes for all the celebrities. So here, in the first experiment, we trained our model for all types of celebrities and just tested it on sportsperson. So there we achieved a blue score of 51. But what if we subtract the sportsperson celebrities from the trained data? Then how well does it generalize on sportsperson? So there you can see there is a drop of 20 blue points, that it goes to 32. One of the reasons here is that the sportsperson entities have these fields, player, the position at which they play, the club they represent, which are very uncommon to the other types of entities present in the graph. So that's why the generalization is not that well. But if you'll see the other experiments that we did was for the artist celebrities. So here, most of the summaries consisted of name, date of birth, and occupation, as we saw for Matt Damon. So these fields are common across all the celebrities. Thus, the drop was not significant, and we were interested in this second set of experiments for this problem. So we need to do more work for domain adaptation.
Skip this button.
Okay.
Okay. So this is the third problem. She was supposed to present it, but I think we'll have to skip it. So this was about generating natural language questions from documents. So here you're given a sentence and the output expected is a bunch of questions from that sentence. So who revealed the appearance of a wormhole or where did it appear and so on. And this is again to introduce some plot-based questions in the chat so that we could collect data from the users. So here again, there was an existing model very recently, 2 months back, done in ACL 2017. And the bottom line is that with some improvements, we were already able to do better than that model. It requires more time and analysis, but we are at least able to do a proof of concept that by our ideas, which is about generating multiple questions from a sentence and what we call as answer-aware generation, we're already able to see some improvements. Okay? Now, this was about the three research problems that we tackled, but building bots is not about just solving research problems. It requires a huge engineering effort, and that's what I'm going to talk about next. So first thing that we had to need to do is crawl a lot of data about movies from various movie sites like IMDb, Rotten Tomatoes, and then Wikipedia, Wikidata, both structured and unstructured data. Then we had to curate this data and store it in our knowledge graphs, and we used a bunch of existing technologies to do that. And finally, we also had to crowdsource and collect a lot of data. So we collected factual questions, paraphrases for them. Then we collected for around 1,000 movies, popular movies, we collected things like, what is your favorite scene in the movie? What is your favorite character and why and so on, right? So a lot of this engineering effort actually goes into that. And finally, of course, we need a bot, right? So we need to develop a web app or a mobile app which can actually chat with users. So we have three versions actually. One is the Facebook integrated messenger. One is one which works on your mobile browser and the one which works on your web browser, which we'll see in the final demo. And we used a bunch of existing technologies to do that. And as all researchers do, I'm really kind of giving very little importance to the engineering effort, but it is really, really important. We had one team member who was completely working on that for full time. Now coming back to the original setup, right? So we collected data. Now we come to what we saw, the ML-NLP problems, we saw the engineering effort, but finally we need to see the bot, right? Did we learn anything from the conversation point of view? So now the problem is chats are really unpredictable. Once you start talking about it, there are several paths that the chat can go about, right? Every person is different. But the idea is, can you have engage the user by steering the conversation along some paths, which are perhaps easier for the bot to handle, and not allow this all possible paths in the thing, right? So we came up with this automata. Again, we had this inspired by this opening game. So here is the opening game. This is the mid game, and this is the end game. And we have designed several transitions. So you see some 16 nodes here, but there are close to 200 paths that can exist between the nodes. For example, from a movie, you could talk about the favorite scene. From the favorite scene, you could talk about a favorite character and why that was favorite, what was the rating, then go back to do a context switch and go back to the actor. So this was a reasonably refined automata that we used for our conversations. And we built a bot which was designed on this strategy, which used all the curated, crowdsourced, collected data and used this automata for conversation. But were we actually successful in engaging the users? So how do we measure that? And I'll skip this. So we did a user evaluation, a very large scale user evaluation. And we had to be careful here, right? So we borrowed ideas from conversation analysis, which is a field in linguistics, that when humans interact with bots, they adapt. So if you're going to tell a user that here's someone who can chat about movies, and if you don't tell them that it's a bot, they're going to behave very differently, right? Now, again, a lot of these participants were actually our friends and relatives and so on. So if you tell them, oh, here's a bot which I have built, go and evaluate it, they would probably be very kind to us and the evaluation would not be fair. So what we told them is, actually there are two bots, okay? One developed by us and one developed by an existing company or university, and we're trying to compare which one is better. Whereas there was in reality only one bot, which was our bot. So they didn't have this bias of always saying good things about the bot because it could have been the other bot also, right? And we gave them a bunch of instructions. So this is an infotainment service. This is not a bot that you can go and talk about life, universe, and everything. This is something which will work for movie domains. So keep your conversations restricted to that. Play nice. Keep the conversation restricted to Hollywood. Play along. That means cooperate with the bot. What we mean by that is if the bot tells you, ask you to do something, just give an honest answer to that and don't try to fool the bot or confuse the bot. And give the bot a chance to offer services. And if you're bored, just say, I'm bored and exist, okay? So we had close to 100 participants which participated in this study. And they were from varied backgrounds, doctors, engineers, MBAs, even kids. So the age group was from 14 all the way up to 57. So wide variety of people. And there was a good, reasonably good mix of gender. We had more males though, but a few females also. And then we asked, after the users were asked to chat with the bot and then asked a bunch of questions. If I told you that you are actually chatting with a human, would you strongly agree, neutral, disagree, strongly disagree? And this is very encouraging that for something which was built in 2 to 3 weeks, 30% of the people thought that they were actually chatting to a human. Okay. Then we asked them, would you like to chat with this bot again in your leisure time? Close to 60% of the people said yes, they would like to talk about it again. And how was your experience chatting with the bot? Excellent, good, and so on. Again, close to 55% people said that it was either good or excellent. Right. So this is really encouraging. I'm not claiming that we have solved the problem, but it's very good to know that within a small period of time, we were able to learn some conversation strategies which would keep the user engaged. And we also looked at the average number of turns or utterances for which we were able to keep the user engaged. And it was good. It was close to 10 to 12 utterances for which the user stayed on the bot, right? And it was hardly ever that the user typed, I am bored, and exited, right? So it was sticking to the bot. And then we asked them, what was one really impressive thing about the bot? So you could read a few things, right? It could go to the next stop relatively quickly. Very interesting to chat about movies. The answers were very accurate. Response was quite fast and so on. What was the one really pathetic thing? It happens when it does not know about a movie which you have picked up, or if it is not able to parse your natural language sentence. A lot of things need to be fixed, but it's an encouraging thing to know that something interesting has come out. Okay. And now coming to the last 3 minutes, planned academic outcomes from this work. Okay, sorry, but yeah. So the title is Experiences in Building Domain-Specific Non-Goal-Oriented Conversation Systems, Crawl, Curate, Crowdsource, Chat, and Collect. I was not aiming for 5 C's here. It just happens that the first word happens to start with C. And the key contributions here are the incremental crowdsourcing idea, all the data curation, collection that we have done, analysis of chats, something around the conversation strategies, user feedback, user studies, and so on. And we could aim for NLP conferences or industrial stack conferences. And it could lead to 1.5 to 2 papers. It's hard to say for now. Definitely, there is one interesting paper here. If we collect more data, have more studies, it could lead to 2 papers, one focusing on engineering, other on social linguistics. Then is factual question answering a solved problem? Experiments with a large-scale domain-specific QA data set and knowledge graph. This could again be an NLP or a deep learning conference paper. And we need around 2 to 3 months to wrap up this work. What's the question? Answer-aware question generation. That was PSE where we already got improvements over an ACL 2017 paper. But this requires more work, maybe 3 to 6 months. And then when to move on, the modified encoder-decoder architecture for generating natural language text from structured data. One key thing here for the judges at least is that only 15 to 20% of this work should be counted as effort done during the workshop. The rest of it was also done outside the workshop, right? So that needs to be mentioned clearly. And data sets developed, we had movie chats, paraphrases, lots of data is there which we could release. And potential scientific effect, over the past 1 year, lots of startups have come up in the chat area. They are addressing different things, customer service, but there are a lot of social things also, like elderly care or healthcare and so on. And the core problems that we're trying to solve are agnostic across domains, right? And if I have to summarize the future work, I just need half a word to do that, which is multi. It could be multi-domain, it could be multilingual, it could be multi-code, it could be multimodal, right? So all these extensions of bots, multilingual, multimodal, multi-code, and multi-domain is what we'd like to work on in the future, right? Okay, thank you. And of course, I have to end with the demo, right? So while there are questions, people can... So we started by saying that we all have had our fun with bots. So we'll end by letting you have your fun with our bot. Yeah, while there are questions, I'll just load the bot. And the Murphy's Law kicks in? No, okay.
Anybody from the audience can come in.
Yeah, if you want to see a movie or something, and I could take questions in the meantime.
I had a couple of questions. Yeah. I would like to know why you compared the performance of your approach with that of memory networks.
So memory networks is the current state of the art for factual question answering, which is like December 2016 is the paper that we are trying to compare with. And there's a bunch of work from this Facebook group led by Jason Weston, which has all their architectures for factual question answering are variants of this memory network. So since we are comparing with that data set, and that's the state of the art currently, that's why we have compared with them.
Okay.
And yes, of course, I see why you're asking this. There's also this parallel work on semantic parsing, which has been led by Percy Liang's group at Stanford. And those things also we tried to compare. But as their code is publicly available, and when we were trying to evaluate that, we realized it's extremely slow. And they have already written that on their Git page that for answering 300 questions, it takes close to 1 day or something like that. So that's the other pure NLP approach to question answering, which is based on semantic parsing.
So did you look at how the bot will respond to unpredictable behavior by the users?
Yes.
When they ask random questions and so on?
Yes. So right now, frankly, the bot is not very good at that. And those are the extra templates that we need to add to the automator, right? So right now, our strategy is like steer the conversation in a particular direction. If you look at this, we always try to make the user go on paths that we are comfortable with. If it deviates, and that was one of the bad feedback that someone gave, right? So it does not, I mean, if I start deviating, it's not able to recognize things. And I'll give you an example. So we said that the user said he wants to talk about Leonardo DiCaprio. Then the bot asked him, which is your favorite Leonardo movie? And the user said, I don't know, right? And it so turns out that I don't know happens to be a movie. So the bot thought that it's saying that I don't know is the movie that it wants to talk about, right? And they said, okay, let's talk about I don't know, even though it's not a Leonardo DiCaprio movie. So those kind of errors, there are a lot of these things. We are aware of these things, but we couldn't get time to actually address all of them in our completion. Okay.
So how does the bot respond to semantic questions? I can give an example. Why Kattappa killed Bahubali?
Yeah.
Answers on Bahubali, so you might get a funny answer. Like this happened during our testing where we were throwing in trivia and the user responded, but I don't like that movie. And to which the bot replied, since this was a crowdsourced data, you need to be at least more than 13 to understand the beauty of this. Where it played with, we were not expecting it to play with, but because it was crowdsourced, it could answer it.
And like to the other thing, right? The problem which I highlighted in blue, which is answering plot-based questions, that's something that we have not addressed, right? So that really needs a lot of attention, and that's something that we hope to work in the future, right? So that's, again, something that people have started looking at in the past 1.5 to 2 years. They call this comprehension style question answering, which is you're given a document. So all that we would have is a script or the IMDb plot or the Wikipedia summary of the movie, and we should be able to answer that question from there. So that's the other research problem.
My last question, what was the non-computer science aspect of this project?
Yes, so the non-computer science aspect was these social linguistic studies that we plan to do on the final data that we have collected. So we have data from a wide variety of audience, right? So it's, they belong to different age groups, and they belong to different professions and different genders. So now we want to see that, is it that a certain demographic tends to talk about a certain kind of movies? Is it that, and the one thing which we clearly observe, right? So the bot was tested by some computer science graduates also. They were not so kind to the bot as compared to the non-computer science graduates, right? Because the non-computer science graduates find this all very interesting, but probably a computer science graduate might start comparing with the other things that they have seen in their AI courses, and they are not very kind, right? So how do people, different people react to bots? So that's one of the social studies that we want to do. The other is these conversational strategies that we came up with. They are based on something in linguistics known as conversation analysis. We have not gone in depth, like Karika tells us there are like textbooks on that. We have not done that. But there are a few recent papers which were pointed to us, and we saw those and incorporated some of these things while designing the templates to engage the user in the strategy. So social linguistics, a bit of that. And that's what when I said in the first paper, it has two components, the engineering part as well as the social linguistic study.
Yeah, I have a question. If you continue on this line and do more work, your current strategy of having one important objective, it appears to be your important objective is to keep the user engaged and retain the time he spends with the app. Is that the only objective?
No.
You'll have to have other objectives later on. You know, it's like a store.
Yes.
Which only wants customers to spend more time in the store.
Right.
And therefore, what would be other possible objectives that you could meet with this technology?
Right. So this has to go towards a goal-oriented kind of a thing, right? At least in the product domain, it should lead to something like better sales, right? So the kind of recommendations that we try to make at the end, it should be useful to the user. And it should be more goal-oriented. So when you come to a product domain or the fashion domain, the user has come to purchase something. And your job as a bot is to help him reach that product or one of its related products, and he should buy that. So that's what is known as the goal-oriented conversation, where the end task is defined. What we are looking at right now is open. There's no goal. He just wants to chat about movies. It's not really that he wants to buy movie tickets or book a ticket or something like that. So the other aspects which are important is does this lead to completion of a task, right? And then in other domains like education and healthcare, things like is the user getting correct answers to its questions? That means, are we doing natural language understanding and natural language generation properly? That is another metric that becomes important in some of these other domains. So right now, yeah, because this is a fun bot, we look at it more like a travel companion or something like that. Their user engagement is probably makes sense, but it's there are a lot of other things that we need to consider in different domains, which are domain specific.
See, that was also my question. And how do you define this end game? If there's no objective, then the end game is just to keep the conversation going, or?
Yes. So the end game, we had three end game templates. One is we get into the recommendation template. So we ask the user, oh, what type of movies do you typically watch? He says action. Any particular actor or director, he says something. And based on that, we try to recommend new movies. Or the other is trivia, right? So we say, oh, I am very good at trivia. Ask me anything about a movie, and I'm sure I can tell you something interesting which you didn't know. So those are just to keep the user engaged, right? There's no other goal for this particular bot. But once we move to different domains, we have to have a goal-oriented bot, right? So that's clearly required.
So you're saying that, so right now in the movie domain, the whole objective is just to entertain.
Yes.
If it was healthcare, there
yes.
might be to answer medical questions.
Medical questions.
Okay. So then how would you tend towards that end? Because right now the whole goal is just to respond to a question, just keep the flow.
Right.
How would you actually push the user towards an end that?
Yes. So there again, so now if the goal is, for example, in the product domain, the success is a buy, right? The moment the user says, oh, I would like to buy that, that's when you know you have succeeded, right? So you have to have a conversation strategy which takes you towards that. And that's what my diagram in the multimodal conversation was, right? That the user starts with, oh, show me some kind of sandals. Then he says, I like the second one, but in beige color. Now this has to continue till the user says, okay, I'm done. This is the one which I want to buy now, right? So the conversation strategy has to keep recommending things which you think are relevant to the user profile, right? So that's how we have to take it forward.
So how do you think your bot will do on multi-hop questions expressed over multiple turns? Will memory networks do better there? I mean, that's in some
definitely
sense.
Definitely not, but our bot will also not do better. The reason is one important problem that we have ignored is coreference resolution, right? So as I said that you might ask who was the lead actor in Titanic, you would say Leonardo DiCaprio. Who is his wife, right? Now this his refers to Leonardo DiCaprio, which requires coreference resolution. So we don't even have an engine for that.
Yeah.
Right?
Do you actually hold explicitly also state of the conversation?
I mean, yeah, we were holding the state of the conversation. So that part is there. Now we just need to plug in a coreference resolution.
How is the state of the conversation expressed? I mean, in terms of slots that you're...
These are not slots. Yeah, we track all the named entities that have been spoken so far, all the movie entities, all the actor entities, character entities that have been spoken for. And what are the templates or the conversation paths that we have already taken so that we don't keep repeating the same paths and it gives a bad experience to the user, right? So
yeah, so again, on the same question, in this example, why did it go to it was nice talking to you goodbye? What was the...
Yes, so we just ended it, right? So we wanted to continue for a few turns. Okay. So we have upper limit just because this was
okay,
demo.
Time right? limited on this one. Okay.
Yeah, we
okay.
just said that we want to do it for 15 turns at max and we just ended there.
So the place where you use the template to generate text, right? Can you just motivate it a bit more for me? I mean, I don't see why. I mean, we could throw simpler techniques
You have
a database. You have a fixed database, and you want to be able to generate natural language text.
Right.
There.
Yes.
And it seems that much simpler techniques would be able to
yes.
do this.
You
with
could,
much greater
yeah.
accuracy.
If the if the knowledge graph is very small, right, then simpler techniques, you could write rules that occupation matters, date of birth matters, name matters, right? But if the knowledge graph has a lot of entities and these entities are differently important for different people, right? For example, Sachin Tendulkar is a cricketer, he's also a Rajya Sabha member, right? Now, but when you give his description, you would probably say the cricketer more and not the other occupation, which is Rajya Sabha member, right? So these kind of rules can be learned from data-driven techniques. But if you try to write these exceptions for everyone, then it becomes a combinatorial problem, right? Because people have different, and now if there was someone who was born in the US, but then settled in India and is now an Indian citizen, Do you really need to say that he was born in the US? So those kind of things become combinatorial, the type of combinations you could have for different data. But if it's a data-driven strategy, it could just learn that out of place of birth and current nationality, probably current nationality is what matters most and so on. Right? So especially if you have a large number of fields in your knowledge graph.
The most important technical novelty in this?
Yes. So the question answering solutions that we have, the newer data set that we have introduced, and the paraphrase detection based solving, and a few other model details which I have skipped, that is one. And the other is the new problem, which is on question generation from plots, right? So there that's a relatively new problem, which is just introduced 3 months back. We're already being able to do better than a state of the art. And we have skipped a bunch of mathematical details in the models that we have. How do we ensure that the context is different from the answer and so on? So those are some technical novelties that we have.
So what about the scalability of your approach?
How many users can access in a time or something like that?
No, the amount of time that it would take.
So this is also one of the good feedbacks that we got from the users is that it's very quick. So the responses, all our models are very, very fast, the question answering and all those models, and they work in real time.
But right now you're doing with very limited amount of data, right? You're working with...
No, the model has been trained, right? So now the model size, even if you have more data, the model size would remain the same. Right? So at test time, we don't have the training data, right? We just need to answer one particular question for which the model size is good enough for it to do it in real time. And that's one of the feedbacks that the people gave that the answers
are very... How about the training time itself?
The training time is like around a day for all the data that we have.
This data is about... This data is about 139.
Okay. So the final goal of having data-driven conversational agents, that we have not even reached, right? Because we don't have enough. With 139 and 2000 chats, we can't even do that. So that we need to collect more data and then train data-driven models. That, if you go that route, you're right, probably these issues will crop up. But right now I was talking about the feasibility of question answering, paraphrases, named entity recognition, and those kind of things. For those problems, the models are really fast and they work well. But we haven't done the end-to-end data-driven conversational bots, right? These are still rule-based with some automata and templates and so on. So these things work fast and they scale well.
So you had focused your work on movies and products, and you talked about multi-domains. So in terms of the approach that you've taken, in terms of the beginning game, mid-game, end-game, and paths that conversations can go, so if you were to switch to another domain, how quickly will this scale to the next domain? So for example, if I wanted to get doctor recommendations or financial advice or, I don't know, help on homework, something like that, how does that scale?
So there's something we call as compatible domains. So now, for example, I'll give you the case from movie to products. So the opening game is, what do you think about the movie X? In the products, there's a very similar opening game. What do you think about iPhone 6S? In the mid game, when you have these movies, people tend to talk about, is it better than the previous one in the sequel? Here you would have, is iPhone 6S better than iPhone 4S? In the end game, it's about, go and watch this movie. Why don't you buy this other product? So in some compatible domains, these strategies are very, very useful. But now from the movie domain, if you switch to healthcare or finance, the strategies are going to be very different. But what would help there is these core problems which you are solving, which is question answering over documents or question answering over knowledge graphs, those would be easily transferable across domains. And that was the idea behind picking up these specific problems which have relevance across multiple domains. Right? Of course, you need to train them with the data in that domain. That's no denying that. But at least the solutions, the models are directly usable there. So model now becomes off the shelf. You just need to feed in new data to that. And across certain compatible domains, definitely the strategies are also transferable. The same example I could repeat for the fashion domain. I want to buy X. There's a recommendation. Is this better than the previous series of shoes they had released and so on? Right? So those kind of things are very transferable across these compatible domains.